come, come. See, your mommy's going.
Iraq war! speaker is going to be Henry Clark from the West County Texas Coalition. Please welcome Henry Clark. Greetings, brothers and sisters. I'm here today to add my voice with yours and the many other people around the country and around the world to saying no new war on Iraq. Now, President Obama, the war criminal that's in the White House, just recently sent 300 and some advisors to Iraq and have warships off the coast. Well, we're here today to send the War Criminal Administration some advice too, to pull those troops out of Iraq, bring them home, and bring that money that you're spending for wars and rumors of wars home here for services. Now, as I indicated, I'm from Richmond. Live next to the Chevron refinery. Well, that oil that pay us for the war in Iraq, that oil is coming to Richmond to be refined at the Chevron refinery. It's already been happening already. Not only do they take the money from my community and many others to fight wars, but they bring the oil to our refineries like Chevron Refinery in Richmond, where we have to face the toxic emissions on a daily basis and the periodic fires and explosions at the refinery in the process of processing this stolen Iraqi oil. You have hospitals like the Doctors Hospital in San Pablo, California, that's in the process of considering closing now because they don't have resources to stay open. This is one of the main hospitals that treat people, the 20-some thousand people that was injured during the August 6th, 2012 fire at the Chevron refinery. Well, if those hospitals are closed, then what are the people going to do? Now, there's plenty of money. There's plenty of money around, but the Obama administration's priorities is not people's needs, it's profit. They're spending up to $2 million every hour on nuclear weapons. And that ain't even considering the 600 and some billions of dollars in the military budget. We say, stop the war, bring the troops home, and money for jobs, not for war in Iraq or Afghanistan or anywhere else. And try Obama, try Kerry, and all the rest of them for war crimes. Crimes against humanity. The United Nations Human Rights Commission have already said that what Obama administration is doing in Guantanamo Bay, and the force feeding of prisoners there, holding many up without charges, that those are human rights violations. Yet, where's Obama and his administration still running around free? But what about war criminals like Robert Taylor and others that the United States want to drag to the Hague to try for war crimes? Justice is what we want. Obama is a war criminal. I don't care if you leave office, you're still a war criminal, and the people in the final end will track you down and bring you before the People's Tribunal and give you and your administration the justice that you deserve. No new war in Iraq. Power to the people.
Yeah.
Money for jobs and education, not for war and occupation. Money for jobs and education,
not for war and occupation.
You want money for jobs and education,
not for war and occupation.
You want money for jobs and education,
not for war and occupation.
Our next speaker is Jimmy Sheehan, is an anti-war activist who is propelled into the movement. By the death of her son in Iraq, Stacy was killed in Iraq. She came out and she has been a force for peace since. She recently ran for governor of California. She's here to share with us today. Please welcome Cindy. Thank you, Natalie. a decade. I remember I was recalling back in 2005, 2006, when I lived over in Berkeley, and I used to take part into the demonstrations, anti-war demonstrations, but I guess they were just really anti-Bush demonstrations. We'd have to have them in the Civic Center because there would be thousands of people. And I was hoping that the Obama administration, if failed, disastrous foreign policy would spur a new, large, principled anti-war movement. But I want the U.S. to leave the people of Iraq alone. You know, people are just concerned because Americans might get killed. And they say, oh, let's just bomb. Bombing will kill more innocent people. And wars aren't going to stop until we stop our young people from joining the military, to be abused by the military-industrial complex, and until we as Americans recognize we're part of a global community, that it's not just American soldiers we should be concerned about. We should be more concerned about the innocent people of Iraq and Afghanistan. And there's two complaints about this new thing in Iraq. People say they don't want to see Iraq. I'm almost finished. They don't want to see Iraq in the hands of fundamentalist Islamists. Anyway, we're the ones that caused the destabilization and the sectarian violence in Iraq. And the other one is Obama's handling of it is destroying or undermining the sacrifices of all the U.S. troops that have died there. I'm here as a mother of one to say, let's honor their sacrifices by leaving the people of Iraq alone. Thank you.
We're going to go on to another chant real quick. So when I say just advisor, you say that's a lie. Just advisor?
That's a lie.
Just advisor?
That's a lie.
Just advisor?
That's a lie.
Just advisor?
That's a lie.
Just advisor?
That's a lie.
Just advisor?
That's a lie.
Just advisor?
That's a lie.
Just advisor?
That's a lie.
Thank you. Our next speaker.
There is no place people struggle in Latin America. And we fight U.S. imperialism in Latin America. And from this work, we know what it means when the U.S. says it's going to send advisors, it's going to send special forces of whatever kind into a country. One thing that it means is the people in those countries can forget about national sovereignty. They can forget about any kind of policies that are going to be in the interest of themselves, right? So it's not that we're just opposed to U.S. military intervention in Iraq now. We're opposed to any kind of U.S. involvement in Iraq. We can look at the history of what the U.S. has done in Iraq, all right? Who's going to be in the government of Iraq? Anyway, so we all know that, right? And we've got to reach out to other people on the left, people who don't know what's going on, bring them into groups, join groups ourselves if we're not already in them, and fight and get the message out there, U.S. out of Iraq.
Yeah. There's a second part to that chant. Now that you know it well, we say, just advisors. Wait, I can't hear you. Just advisors? Where the Pentagon goes, people die. Just advisors? Where the Pentagon goes,
people die.
Just advisors?
Where
the Pentagon goes,
people die.
Just advisors? Where the Pentagon goes,
people die.
Just advisors? Where the Pentagon goes,
people die.
Thank you. Our next speaker today is Omar Ali. He's an Egyptian activist for the Answer Coalition. Answer sounds for Act Now to Stop War and End Racism. Please welcome Omar.
Yeah.
No justice, no peace. U.S. out of the Middle East. No justice,
no peace.
U.S. out of the Middle East.
Brothers and sisters, yet again.
the U.S. administration of Obama is continuously spreading lies throughout the media, talking about military intervention into Iraq. It is the first military intervention in 2003 that caused the catastrophe that we are in today in Iraq. Over 5 million Iraqis have been displaced and made refugees since the war in 2003. More than 5 million Iraqis have died as a result of this conflict. But not only that, the sanctions in the 90s of the sanctions, the sanctions that killed over 1.5 million Iraqis, mainly women and children, because the Iraqi government could not sustain an economic budget to buy medicine, food, and sustain water development in Iraq. This is the same hypocrisy that we see, whether Democrat or Republican, it's the same single thing. When they claim that there's no budget for education in this country, or social services, or health care, but there's always billions of dollars that go into the military-industrial complex. Amen. We've seen this once again over and over and over. Amen. They continuously find proxies throughout the Middle East. Now in Egypt, it's the military regime that's back in full fledge. Just recently, the Egyptian government said it's going to execute over 800 Egyptians for demonstrating against the regime. 800. And yet the U.S. is turning another blind eye because Egypt continuously secures American hegemony in that region. And people have to be aware that our current stance in Syria, the continuously funding of reactionary forces in Syria, has spilled over into Iraq and continues destabilizing the country and the region as a whole. The bottom line of the U.S. administration, whether it be you have been Bush or Obama, has been profit and the control of resources in the Persian Gulf in the Middle East for the past several decades. One last thing is that until now, Bush, Cheney, Rumsfeld, all the people who have been under the administration and instigated this war are still running around loose.
Right.
One last thing. When Obama talked in Brussels, in Belgium, a couple of months ago, he said the most arrogant thing in the world. He said, oh, the United States did not annex Iraq, it did not annex Iraq's resources in conjunction with what's going on in Crimea. Just the bottom line is that the United States will pursue anything at all costs to destroy the Middle East and control its resources. Please sign up at the booth over there at the end of the coalition. Thank you.
Yeah.
Iraq war!
Not again.
Iraq war! 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 Iraq war!
Our next speaker is going to be Rosa Pinata. Pinata?
Come on, people! We're fired! We're taking over! Number one, and here we are again. You know, fighting another is another thing about the United States going to war against Iraq. We have to stop these crazy things about the United States going everywhere, whatever they want, just to kill people. No more war.
No more.
More war means more taxes. More war means social problems going down the drain, my goodness. More war means education. Education suffering. Schools are not getting the money they need to function properly, and our kids are suffering because the education they're getting is not enough. Because there is not enough money. Schools are going down, education is suffering. We are all suffering. There is nothing glamorous about going to war. War is suffering, killing. And so, okay. United States is a country that wants to dominate the whole world, and whatever they need, petroleum, they come here. There are stations, the military bases all over the world in 159 countries. We have to fight for to defend Venezuela. We have to get United States military bases out of Latin America. No more war anywhere in the world. And United States, get out of Latin America.
We want money for jobs and education. San Francisco, who are not yet understanding the importance of demonstrating right now against the U.S. threats in Iraq. So, as we speak today about this looming threat, let's not just look at a fragment of reality. Let's look at a wider angle. The current crisis in Iraq and Syria is a nightmare for those people there. And whenever imperialist wars and aggression are on the loose in this world anywhere, death and destruction are raining down on people whose lives are no less precious or important than our own. The crisis in Iraq is of a piece with other horrors created under the so-called global war on terror. Today, and with Dr. Clark's permission, I'd like you to look at this orange banner. Today is day 500 of the prisoners' hunger strike at Guantanamo. People ask us, how is it possible that they're not dead yet? It's because they're being tortured every day by being force-fed and beaten and kicked. And last week, we saw the 10th anniversary of the first U.S. drone strike on Pakistan. Think about it. A high school student today was in the third grade that day. And she or he was in kindergarten during shock and awe in 2003. They have never known a world defeat that is any other way. This crisis is a nightmare for the Iraqi people, but this nightmare is 23 years and continuing. It began with the first U.S. invasion. Omar told you the horrors, the million dead, the 4 or 5 million refugees. I won't repeat what Omar said. I will say this. Here comes the U.S. again trying to fix Iraq, whether it's Tomahawk missiles, whether it's conventional bombs from B-52s, whether it's drone strikes. All of this will only mean unspeakable horror. Further horror for the people of Iraq. And I add, a drone strike in the mountains of Afghanistan is one thing. A drone strike in a densely populated urban area in Iraq is another thing entirely. We cannot let the empire fool people into supporting this. And the most dangerous word right now in the English language when it comes out of the mouth of the president is we. This hypocritical pronoun. We do not want to dominate the Middle East. We do not want to live in a world that's ruled by the most violent empire humanity has ever seen. Right now we need to stand up, expose, and stand up to this war, and if we don't yet have the millions in the street that we had in 2003, this is what we must work for. No bombs on Iraq, no drone strikes, no puppet regime change, no secret ops, no war material, no attacks on Iraq. The Iraqi people are our sisters and brothers. Stop the war crimes of our government. The world can't wait.
Yeah.
No justice, no peace.
U.S. out of the Middle East.
No justice, no peace.
U.S. out of the Middle East.
No justice, no peace.
U.S. out of the Middle East.
No justice, no peace. Thank you. Our next speaker is going to be Megan Adams from Word, which stands for Women Organized to Resist and Defend.
So, it almost seems like it'd be a question to, you can see that there's all of these women who are out here, and I'm from one of the, from a women's organization called Word, and we're out here today because of the reasons that all of these, that are on all of these signs that everybody's coming out here for, that everybody said already, is that there needs to be no new war on Iraq, because who is the ones that suffered? It's all the people that are there. It's the women who were killed by the bombs, by the drones, by all the half a million children who were killed in the first Iraq war back in the 90s. And so it's Pakistan, it's Yemen, Afghanistan, Iraq, the women and children who die in Palestine from the sanctions and the U.S. support of Israel there. It's the women and children who are dying in Syria. And that we know that looking at this while the president's talking about military intervention in Iraq, that this is not a war for us. That they are not doing this for any reason that's actually going to benefit any of the people who are here. They're doing this for the corporations and all of the big businesses who are going to profit off of the suffering and the murder of those people over there. And so that's why we are here, to say no new war on Iraq, that we need to pull all the troops out, close all of the military bases everywhere around the world. So, just to do a quick wrap up, because I know that we're going to get ready and do some marching, that so we hope that you stand with us and no new war on Iraq.
Marching to where?
I don't know, probably down there.
Let's do that.
Iraq war, not again! Iraq war!
Think about all these people dead. That's what the U.S. has been doing in Iraq. And the U.S. is seeing with the military intervention in Latin America, in Venezuela, in Cuba. And the U.S. has trained its terrorists in Miami to do terrorist attacks in Cuba. We have hurt over 2,000 people in the country. And the five who came here to the U.S. to infiltrate the troops and try to stop terrorism without shooting one bullet. That's what they were doing. And what the U.S. government does, they go, they arrest the five, and they're being imprisoned for over 15 years now. The U.S. claim that they are fighting terrorism, but no, they are sponsoring terrorism, they are the terrorists attacking the world, and they are putting in jail those who try to stop them. So we are here to say, put the fight now and stop the war in Iraq. Thank you.
Money for jobs and education. 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 Our next speaker will be Larry Everest from Revolutionary Newspaper and author of the book Oil, Power, and Empire, reported from Iraq.
Thank you. Barack Obama said that the U.S. military is in Iraq to, quote, give Iraqis an opportunity to claim their own future. Bullshit! The U.S. military is in Iraq to conquer Iraq for imperialism. Obama said the problem is because, quote, Iraqi leaders have been unable to overcome their differences. Bullshit! You put those Iraqi leaders into power. Obama doesn't talk about the Iraqi suffering. He talks about the, quote, extraordinary sacrifices of the Americans. Bullshit. What about 4 million injured? What about 5 million refugees? What about 1 million Iraqis dead? And what about adding jet fuel to reactionary Islamic fundamentalism? There is no answer for the people. More U.S. intervention is just going to make this worse. So hell no. Hell no. This crisis shows as long as imperialism exists, these wars are never going to stop. But it also shows these rulers are not all-powerful. They launched the war on terror to strengthen their empire. It's weakened their empire. But we need to bring forward another way that's not imperialism or religious fundamentalism. An alternative to both. In the Middle East and right here, we need a revolution to uproot all oppression, including women's oppression. We need revolution based on Bob Avakian's new synthesis of communism for a visionary and viable world.
Yeah.
And he has a strategy to get there. The system is in trouble. Revolution is possible. Revolution newspaper says prepare the ground, prepare the people, and prepare the vanguard to get ready for the time when millions can be led to go for revolution. All out with a real chance to win. No intervention in Iran. No intervention in Iraq. No intervention anywhere in the Middle East. Revolution, nothing less. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just advisors? Guys, just advisors, that's the lie. Where the Pentagon goes, people die. Just advisors?
That's the lie.
Just advisors?
That's the lie.
Where the Pentagon goes,
people die.
Where the Pentagon goes,
people die.
Is it just advisors?
That's the lie.
Just advisors?
That's the lie.
Where the Pentagon goes,
people die.
I can't hear you. Where the Pentagon goes,
people die.
All right, so we are going to march today. We are going to get in the streets. And we know that that is the way to stop the U.S. wars of aggression, is to come out, to organize ourselves, and to get on the streets. So I want everyone to stick around. We have some more speakers, and then we'll be going into the streets with our message of no new war in Iraq. So please stick around and invite your friends. They got time to get here. So our next speaker is Nancy Mancia. She's from Code Pink.
Yay!
And working in Taiwan.
All right, where are my co-speakers at? Come on up here, sister. Come on up. Come on up here. Sisters and brothers, we stand in solidarity with you and the people of Iraq. How many remember when we shut down this city when the first bomb dropped on Iraq? Raise your hand if you remember that. If you were in the streets and you helped shut down this city. We as an anti-war community stood strong against the U.S. invasion on Iraq. And now today we stand again to say no military intervention, no airstrikes, no drone strikes on Iraq. You would think by now we would learn from our mistakes. You would think that we wouldn't be having these discussions, which are doing nothing more but reopening the wounds for Iraqi refugees, for Iraq veterans, for military families. We should be ashamed of ourselves for revisiting this shame. We will never have closure in Iraq until we hold Bush, Cheney, Donald Rumsfeld, Condoleezza Rice, and the rest of the criminals accountable for destroying Iraq and for bankrupting this country. When the U.S. strikes happen in Iraq, we need tens of thousands again to take the streets to say no war on Iraq. So thank you, brothers and sisters, for giving us this time to address you today. Please visit our website. Thank you, as a coalition, for organizing these actions and these protests that are happening across the country today. Thank you.
So our next speaker is going to be Judy Greenspan from the Workers World Party.
Sisters and brothers, I bring you solidarity greetings from Workers World Party. We salute people all over the world who are fighting to get free from the tentacles of U.S. imperialism. I want to make something very clear. Obviously, many of us have been, this is the third time that we have seen an open aggression or a plan against Iraq. But it's not a new war. This war has been going on from before the U.S. undermined the government of Saddam Hussein. This war of greed of power to control the oil. And the bombing is already happening. The U.S. has resumed their drone strikes in Pakistan. Israel is bombing Gaza and Palestinians in the guise of searching for someone who kidnapped a few Israeli young people. My guess is the U.S. and Israeli government kidnapped them as a guise to continue the aggression against the Palestinian people who are fighting for unity and fighting for the government. So the war is happening. The question is, what are we going to do about it? And are we going to be fooled? You know, a lot of times the anti-war movement is very compartmentalized. So we're out here about Iraq. We might say a few words about Syria. But there is a war going on that the U.S. is leading against the Ukraine. There is a war that the U.S. is leading against Venezuela, against the people in the Bolivarian circle who are fighting against U.S. imperialism in Ecuador and Bolivia. There's a war going on in Brazil where the people are fighting for jobs and were forced to build by imperialism an incredible stadium which cost so much money.
It was 3 years after the bombing of Iraq, which was aimed at destroying the entire civilian infrastructure of the country. And we should remember that in September and October of 1990, before that war took place, there was a serious discussion at the top in the U.S. And the idea was floated that the water supply to Iraq could be cut off. The water supply to, I mean, imagine a mainly desert country, what it would mean to cut off the water. And the way the war was carried out in January and February of 1991 had nothing to do with getting troops out of Kuwait and everything to do with returning Iraq, as some of them put it at that time, to an earlier stage of history. 1994, when I went the first time, you could see that what had been a tremendously modernized country in a very short period of time had nothing to keep its institutions going. When you went to the hospitals, you saw people, families who were gathered there with dying children. People did not go to the hospital anymore by 1994 except to die, because there was nothing in the hospital to treat them with. When you went to the pharmacy, there was nothing, absolutely nothing. And that was 20 years ago, 20 years ago. And what has Iraq seen since then? 20 years of bombing, of blockade, of deprivation, of starvation, and then more bombing. And then when that hadn't succeeded in bringing about regime change, which was always the real objective, then we had shock and awe and the invasion and occupation of the country. If that is what is done to a country, particularly a developing country, for 23 years, what are the consequences going to be? We are seeing the consequences play out today in a country that's lost millions of people. Of a country of 26 million, that's lost millions who have either been killed or wounded or driven into exile, and their society, which was a secular society and a quite tolerant society, torn apart, and the people within that society by the deliberate action and intention of Washington and London pitted against each other in sectarian and ethnic and religious conflict. Right. So that is what we are seeing play out today, the consequences. We believe that the people of Iraq will recover. There's proud people who resisted colonialism, who had a revolution, who through a secular development program modernized their country in record time, and we believe that they will come back. But we cannot for one moment ignore the tragedy that has been imposed upon that country. But saying that, we have to ask ourselves the question, so what do we do now? And what we do now is say, no more U.S. intervention, get out, close down that monstrous embassy with all its security personnel. No more, no 300 advisors, no bombing, no drones, U.S. out of Iraq, U.S. out of the Middle East. That's who's caused the misery and the suffering for the people of that whole region beyond any other factor. So even though we wish we were thousands out here today, we are going to continue as we have been continuing since then to fight against this war and against all the wars. You know, the last thing I want to say is this, is that the Anti-Coalition initiated the demonstration. Many other organizations have joined in. The Anti-Coalition has made many signs, printed thousands of flyers for this, done a lot to make it happen. And we'd like to ask you today if you can make a donation to help us cover the expenses of today and going forward with all that we have to do. So if you want to write a check, a tax-deductible check, you can do it to Progress Unity Fund. Progress Unity Fund supports, generously supports the work of the Anti-Coalition. But any donation you can make, from a dime to $100, we appreciate it very much, and it will help us carry on the struggle. U.S. out of Iraq!
Our next speaker is going to be Forrest Smith from the March 4th. He is also a military veteran. Welcome, Forrest.
Just like every other war that the U.S. has engaged in, which the history of the U.S. is one war after another, all of them somehow defensive wars, somehow fought on someone else's soil. But every war, the excuses are trotted out, the lies are trotted out, because they know that the people of the United States would not tolerate it if they came out and said, hey, we need to steal Iraq's resources. We want to re-enslave the people of Iraq by dividing them against themselves. We want to destroy their infrastructure. We want to geopolitically control that region and use it as an unsinkable aircraft carrier to destroy other countries. We would say no. So they lie to us. And then, once the soldiers are there, and as the soldiers are being sent there, they lie again saying that the war is to defend those soldiers. And they speak in the name of U.S. soldiers, the 17 and 18-year-olds. But those 17 and 18-year-olds, and I was one of those 17-year-olds who fortunately did not have to shoot at someone, and fortunately did not ever get shot at, but we were lied to. When we signed on the dotted line, they didn't say, here, you're going to help enslave people, you're going to destroy countries, you're going to dominate the world. They said, here's job training, when we didn't have any. They said, here's college money when we didn't have any. Here's health care. For the many kids, for the first time, got dental care and eyeglasses in the military and didn't have any access to them before that because it's a wonderful health care system in America. And if they didn't go for the college money, the jobs, the eyeglasses, they were told that they were going to defend democracy, that they were fighting to free people. And then they got there, and they saw the lie. And then, when they spoke out and said, these wars must be stopped and we won't keep fighting for this lie, then actual soldiers were never spoken for. They speak about soldiers in general, but never those particular soldiers like Chelsea Manning and the numerous other soldiers who stood up and said, we will not continue to fight, and we will actually stand on the other side fighting for humanity, and that the brothers and sisters in Iraq are just that, our brothers and sisters, not our enemies. And that those soldiers who stand up and refuse to fight, those are the ones we support. It is not supporting soldiers to make them fight, die, and kill for a lie. And in the name of those soldiers, in the name of the Iraqi people, we must stand up. We must organize. If it's one person, anywhere you're at, in Salinas, Half Moon Bay, anywhere, you must stand up, and you will not be one person for long, and you will find veterans standing next to you fighting against these atrocious wars, this imperialism.
Yeah. As a public school teacher, this chant very important to me as I see our kids go without food, without health care, often without housing. Tens of millions of children sleep outside of houses in this country every night, and I see the effects of it in my classroom. And at the same time, the government is spending trillions of dollars on war to do the same thing, to force children and their families out of their homes in other countries. We have nothing against the children, against the mothers and fathers, against the people of Iraq, of Afghanistan, of Palestine, of Syria, of any of the countries that have been on the target list of the United States government. So this chant is particularly important as we stand with all of the people in the United States who go hungry, who don't have houses, who are facing the attacks on public education and with our brothers and sisters around the world that are living in far worse conditions because of the actions of the U.S. government. Money for jobs and education, not for war and occupation. Money for jobs and education,
not for war and occupation.
We want money for jobs and education,
not for war and occupation.
We can be a whole lot louder than that. This has got to be our movement, and we have to own it. So I won't want to hear you. I can hear you. But they should be able to hear you in City Hall. They should be able to hear you in Washington, D.C., in the White House, in the halls of Congress, who are the people leading these attacks. So we want money for jobs and education.
Not for war and occupation.
Money for jobs and education.
Not for war and occupation.
We want money for jobs and education.
Not for war and occupation.
That's
better. You know, this is these people need to resolve their issues and learn the lessons of democracy. Well, here's the thing we need to repeat to people as we talk to them. Not only is the U.S. not the solution to the problems in Iraq, it is actually the problem. There's a reason that Iraq is now approaching being a failed state, and that's the U.S. occupation and invasion. The U.S. has a strategy in the Middle East. They want to overthrow or weaken independent states. They want to get rid of all strong states. They want weak states so that the U.S. can rule. And we can see that going back all the way to at least a half a century. We can see that in the 1953 coup in Iran. We can see in the late 70s, early 80s in Afghanistan, up to the time when they overthrew the state in Afghanistan. We can see that in the occupation of Iraq in 2003, earlier in 1991. We can see that in the overthrow of the Libyan state. And we can currently see that in the drive to overthrow the regime in Syria. These are not accidents, these are not mistakes. Washington knows what it's doing. It's not all powerful. What is developed in Iraq today is not what Washington wanted. What they want is that they want to use these forces like they did the Mujahideen in Afghanistan. Up to a couple of months ago, ISIL, Islamic State of Iraq and the Levant, was broadly categorized as the pro-democracy forces, right? And then things have changed now. So when we ask the question, what is happening, why, you know, because the thing is that Washington then comes out and the media and say to the people of the Middle East, you people are so fundamentalist. You have these Islamic fundamentalists there. Well, this is after a half a century and more of the U.S. along with its clients overthrowing independent states, weakening the forces on the left, weakening the nationalist forces in the Arab world. And what's left is fundamentalist forces. The people resist. But who takes the leadership? When you've destroyed the left, when you've destroyed progressive nationalism, this is what happens. ISIS or ISIL has been receiving help from U.S. client states, Saudi Arabia and Qatar, who funded them. They've been in the border areas of Jordan and Turkey, and that's how they have gained their strength. It's no accident. So then that's when they play down their war on terrorism. That's when Washington does that. And then when something else happens, all of a sudden the terrorism war comes up. So again, it's great that we're here today. We should keep it very clear. The U.S. is the problem in the Middle East, in Iraq in particular. And there's nothing that the U.S. can do that would be motivated to resolve the issue. There's nothing that the U.S. can do other than things that will make the issues worse. Bombings, more problems, more killing. So it's great that we're here. Let's march on the street in a minute, and let's be very clear on our message. No U.S. intervention in the Middle East.
Yeah.
Justin!
Thank you. is a crime. Occupation 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 is a crime.
Infrastructure. What does that mean? It means people having houses, people being able to turn on the faucet and get clean running water. It means being able to walk into a room and flip on the lights and have them come on. That's infrastructure. That takes organization, it takes government, it takes many different things, and it was destroyed. Not by the Iraqi people, by the U.S. government and its military. The largest military ever on this planet went after the Iraqi people. And now they're in a civil war. Now, after that, they're suffering. And the U.S. government, who bears the responsibility for that destruction, has the gall to say we need to intervene. They're going to send, they have sent, 300 military advisors. But those aren't just advisors. The idea that that's just an advisor is a lie. Those advisors are military personnel with training. And they're there to train others. And they're there. And what if one of them gets killed? What happens then? What does the U.S. government say when one of their advisors is dead? So we're here today to say that this pretext for war has to end. And that in fact, every single U.S. troop should be pulled out of Iraq. No more should be sent. And reparations are owed to the Iraqi people. The trillions of dollars spent on war should be turned over to two sets of people. People who have everything in common. And that is the people of Iraq, the innocent people of Iraq and Afghanistan, and the working people of this country. We should have housing, jobs, education here and in Iraq. That's what we're calling for today.
I'd like to thank everyone. Thank everyone for coming out. We just like to remind everyone, like, this is not possible. We cannot end this war if we do not get out in the streets to organize. None of this is possible. We need you. We need workers. We need men and women. We need everyone to come together in solidarity with the men and women of Iraq. Right now, we have sign-up sheets going around. If you could please just sign up, volunteer in any way you can. We have sign-up sheets at the desk. Please, we need you to come out and volunteer and help us end this war, help us end the American military industrial complex, and help the men and women and children of Iraq. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming out. Iraq won!
No more!
Iraq won!
No more!
Iraq won!
No more!
Iraq won!
No more!
Thank you. Thank you so much for coming out. Also, there will be a speak out after this. Word, women organizers are resisting the ban. We have a speak out for Marissa Alexander. So if you could please stay for that right here. It's going to be happening right now. So if you please, 2 o'clock. And so if you could please come to that. It'll be right here at 2 o'clock. And also, if any invasion does happen, if any bombing does happen, we'll be coming out right here in this very same spot, Answer Coalition, at 5 p.m.
And everybody else, and tell your friends, if the U.S. attacks with a new bombing or drone or any other new attack, on the day of 5 p.m., meet here. Bring everybody. And if it happens at night, come out at 5 p.m. the following day. Bring your sounds, bring your voices and your signs and your banners. Get ready to get out of your comfort zone, everybody who's listening over there but not joining us.